two or three or maybe four of his books, heard him speak, but I firmly believe that Dr.Rogness is one of the great gifts to our society. Somebody was asking this morning how we could get more people to chapel, and I said, I'm not sure, even if we had Jesus Christ, if we could get everyone on campus to chapel. And I said, but we have the closest thing to Jesus Christ here today. And I say that, of course, partly in jest, but partly because I have been able to observe Dr. Rogness in his warmth and his spirit in many ways as a student at the seminary, as a person who watched the vacation at Lake California, where my father also has a cabin, and he's a wonderful person. We walked with his wife also, Mrs. Rogness, that you're seeing by the names. We're also pleased that the choir will sing at the stage. We're having a focus on the Reformation Day. We do not have chapel, of course, on Thursday, and Thursday is Reformation Day. So this morning we are going to sing the Great Reformation Hymn, and Mighty Fortresses of God. I also want to bring to your attention the banner that is behind us. The Reformation banner was made by our new Vice President for Development and Public Relations, Keating Aaron. I also want to thank you for the many prayers that were extended to my grandmother over the last 2 weeks. She did die yesterday, and the funeral will be on Friday. And thank you for that service of support. To begin our worship this morning, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Please stand and sing the hymn.
Thank you. think that you've all heard of Alvin Rogness. But I know that as a tool on the campus where I was to work. I now wander around occasionally and I'll introduce myself to one of the students. I'll say I'm Alvin Rogness, or I'll say I'm Mr. Robinson. And she would say, yeah, how do you spell that? It doesn't take long before you receive into history. In Arthur Miller's play, After the Fall, you have the story of a man, a lawyer, in his middle years, whose life is falling apart. And at the first part of the play, he had a remarkable line. He said, I think I've always thought of life as a piece of law. When you're young, you prove how strong and smart you are. Later, what a good mother. Later, what a good father. And when you grow old, you prove how wise and mighty you are. And then he said, but I've always thought that I was going up to a point, God knows where I will be justified, if not justified, condemned, a verdict anyway. And then he said, my trouble began when one day I looked up and the bench was empty. There was no judge in sight. And life was an endless conversation with myself. And here's the great line. A pointless litigation of existence before an empty bench, which is to say despair. I don't know if we thought enough about how important it is to have the high court and someone on the bench to judge us. Imagine that we didn't have that, and that we weren't regarded as important enough in existence to have a verdict to be either justified or condemned. That we might be ants and the dog and the chimpanzee were not designed to be judged. But we were given the gift of freedom. We were created in the image of God. We were given the right to judge between right and wrong, and the right to be judged. And that's a tremendous important point. But it's not all very apparent to appear in the High Court, which we all do day after day, to be judged. Because in the High Court, unlike the courts of the land, we're not about to ask for justice. In all the courts of the land, that's what you want. You hire an attorney so that you get what's coming to you. But who will be audacious enough to stand in the High Court and tell God, all I want is a fair deal? I'm not asking for favors. Give me what I have come in, no more, no less. You know, and I know, that we will never make that appeal in the High Court. And in the words of the Psalms, if thou, Lord, shouldst count iniquities, and that's what the court is about, O Lord, who is king, there is none good, no, not one, by the high standards. And so we'll cry for mercy. And fortunately, there is mercy. The miracle court. And this is the strange story of the gospel. The miracle of the court is that the judge levies the charge. levies the verdict against us, and you all stand undone. But then, the judge steps down from the bench and takes the sentence that was given us upon himself, and pays the penalty, goes to the cross, and removes our sins as far east as from the west. There is no guilt anymore. Your sins are forgiven and forgotten. Church had inadvertently allowed their people to live primarily with the bench and not with the cross. And it was Luther's great work and the work of the reformers to shift the attention away from the cross, which could only destroy us and could only paralyze. To the cross, where we have forgiveness and life and salvation without Christ and with no condition forever. It's a dangerous thing, however, to get caught with that. Probably we could better live with a bench and take our chances, because they're set free. If Christ sets us free, we are free indeed. Using another figure, he buys us. He buys us and then sets us free. He doesn't say, now I have fortune. You come under a new contract. The old contract was gone. There's a new one. In a sense, that's the language that's used. But it's as if he were to buy us and then say, now go be away. He didn't buy us in order to make us his own. And he put us under a new law, kind of law. He said, go your way. He was counting on our having been set free, that we spontaneously, out of gratitude and love, would follow him. And the demands of discipleship, the noblesse oblige that we come under, having been set free, is every bit as exacting as the bench ever demanded. But it's a glorious type of feat. And it's the kind of freedom that he designed us to have, the freedom not to do willingly what we want to do, but the freedom to follow him, the freedom to do what we want to do. So he takes from, he removes the dominion of the evil one and enables us to live lives of service and love and hope. Don't sin. In the bench of God, I glory. So let's do better glory in that too. Because if it weren't there, life would be chaos and means. But we sin in the cross of Christ.
Thank you.
Quie, former Governor Quie, will also be speaking.